So today we'll talk about how Sanatan Dharma is growing around the world. And the topic is affirming Sanatan Dharma and recording the modern history of a billion strong global religion in Renaissance. So let's go to Cambodia. So in Cambodia, we have the prehistory of Cambodia starts with one king called Kambuja Raja, a Brahminical king of India, who comes to this region and then he has a battle with a lady here in this country, Mero, and then they get married. And the country they jointly ruled is called Kambuja Desha, and their descendants are called the Khmer people. So Kambuja Desha later on became Kampuchea, and then it became Cambodia. So that's how it is. So it has got an Indian origin, Kambuja Desha. So the origin of the language spoken was Mon Khmer. Late in 6th century, the Mon people moved further west to Thailand, and the Khmer remain in the current day Cambodia. So the Mon and Khmer went in two different directions. Mon moved to Thailand. So Indian influence in this region began in the 1st century CE. They traded goods with Khmer by the way of sea. When spice and silk trade flourished, both Indians and Chinese exerted their influences on local people, but Indian culture took a firm foothold, perhaps due to the efforts of the Brahmin priests. The rulers of that time had a suffix Varman, similar to the Pallava kings of Kanchipuram. So supposedly, the Pallava kings had their influence on Cambodia. While the Cholas of Tanjavur in India eventually defeated the Pallava Varmans, the Khmer kingdoms flourished well into 14th century. So the Pallava influence continued in Cambodia while here Cholas took over. Though all the rulers of Cambodia bore the name Varman, they did not necessarily belong to the same dynasty. They just took that name, Jayavarman, like that. At various periods in their history, rulers and usurpers came from Siam, Thailand and Champa, Vietnam into Cambodia. So if you see Mahabharata, there is reference to Siam, there is reference to Champadesh, which are like the subsidiaries of the Mahabharata kings who ruled from Delhi. And Kambuja Desha is also mentioned, which is Cambodia or Kampuchea. So there are historical references suggesting that Cambodia has been inhabited in 3rd millennium BCE. Chinese travelers later chronicled the first established kingdom. The first kingdom was called Funan, an alteration of the word Benam or mountain. A certain Kaundinya, inspired by a dream, traveled from India and married a local princess, Soma, belonging to the Naga tribe. Again, if you look at Mahabharata, there is a reference of different tribes who came and participated in the battle. So all these people came to the Delhi area to fight Kurukshetra, from Cambodia, from Thailand, from Vietnam. So this Kaundinya established the first dynasty of Funan. Later in 5th century, second traveler from India, Kaundinya Jayavarman, arrived and focused on re-establishing the Indian culture. He established a more defined Funan kingdom and later followed by Rudravarman. So you will see that all these kings have Varman at the name. Even in India right now, you have people with the name Varman. And in the north, you'll see Varma, means Kshatriyas usually have that title, kings. So he was responsible for most of the first sculptures, mostly of Lord Vishnu in Cambodia. So after the decline of Funan kingdom, Khmer people established Chenla kingdom, where the names of King Shrutavarman and Shrestavarman are mentioned. Again, everybody has this name Varman, although they are from different families. So they established their capital in Shrestapura. Later, Ishana Varman from the Khmer kingdom of Bhavapura defeated the remains of the Funan and established their capital in Ishanpura. So all these names are very much Indian names, South Indian names actually. like Shruta Varman, Shrestha Varman. So because of the influence of the Pallava dynasty from predominantly Tamil Nadu, that has established its influence in Cambodia. So Jayavarman I followed him, and then the successor Pushkaraksha again united the splintered principalities in the year 716, and his capital was called Shambhupura. So all these names have again transferred into their local dialect. It became Shambhur. His heirs maintained control over kingdom until end of 8th century, when Malayans and Javanese gained dominion over many Khmer principalities. Again, even in Java, in Sumatra and in Malaysia, you had heavy South Indian influence there. So even their names were also like that, Jayavarman, Krutavarman, like that. So during the pre-Angkor Wat period, many temples were built, though they did not demonstrate the same style of architecture or confidence of the later builders. So as you can see from this, Vietnam, Thailand, Bali, parts of Indonesia, because Indonesia later on became Muslim and all the Hindus moved to Bali. And I'm going to talk about that also. So all these people had heavy influence from South India. So which means there was an active trade, shipment trade going between South India and these places. So all of Southeast Asia was originally Vaishnava. And then later on, slowly they became, because the Muslim preachers were very active in the region, mostly became Muslim. Some became Christian. Christian preachers also became active from the 1500s onwards with the Dutch rulers and so on. So you see in the sides of the mountains, they have giant faces of Brahma carved. So the glory of Cambodia and its temples began earnest in the rule of Jayavarman II. It is thought that he came from royal court in Java. So not only the Indian influence went to Southeast Asia, but then people, there was interplay between Java, Sumatra, Bali, Cambodia, Vietnam, Thailand. So there was Vaishnava influences between these countries. So what he did, he declared and unified a sovereign Kambuja Desha, independent of Javanese influence. So he didn't let Javanese influence stay. The Kambuja influence from India was there. And this was the era when the Angkor era in the history of Cambodia was born. He named his capital Harihara Alaya. Alaya means temple. Hari means Lord Vishnu. Hara means Lord Shiva. Harihara Alaya, that's how he named his capital city. Even in India, you don't have such beautiful names, right? In Cambodia, Vietnam, Thailand, you have very, very Vedic names. In Thailand, when I went to Bangkok, one of the road is called Lord Rama Road. In Delhi, you don't have a Lord Rama Road. But in Bangkok, you have a Lord Rama Road. And introduced the Linga cult, means the Shivalinga. The cult of Devaraja or God King, the terrestrial counterpart of the celestial being, was also introduced by Jayavarman, which means king is a representative of God, which is also what is said in Bhagavad Gita 5,000 years ago. So the capital stayed around the large lake Tonle Sap and around the city of Siem Reap until the demise of the Hindu empires. So after that, the capital moved to Phnom Penh. Today it is in Phnom Penh. 30 years after Jayavarman II's death, the successor Indravarman constructed the first major temple in his honor, one of the so-called rulers group of temples. From then on, the rulers busied themselves in building temples using bricks, sandstone, and laterite. Often they painted in bright colors. They also built large water reservoirs called barais. Following Indravarman I, his son Yashovarman built many more temples and barais. So this is a lesson for us. If we build a temple in America, we should have large water reservoirs. We should build them using bricks, because here buildings are constructed using wood, right? Temples are rarely constructed with wood. They're constructed with bricks, sandstone, and limestone, laterite, like that. So Rajendra Varman in 10th century was a ruler busy building another half a dozen temples and best preserved an architectural masterpiece at Bante Srai, which is one of the towns in Cambodia. So as you can see, Cambodia was a major Vedic Vaishnava culture. Major Vedic Vaishnava culture. The names of the towns were like Harihara Alaya, right? They, and their, even their king's names are all Vedic kings' names. Right now in India, you have people's names like Bobby Singh. Bobby doesn't mean anything, right? They didn't have those silly names. They had real Vaishnava names. And after that, during the rule of Udita, Udayadiyata Varman II, several lingas, Shivalingas, were carved on the riverbed on Phanom Kulen called Mahendra Parvata. So I'll show you some pictures, beautiful pictures of Shivalingas on the riverbed itself. So from the mountain, as the river is flowing through the rock, they carved Shivalingas. And even after the wear and tear, you can still see those Shivalingas. It was believed that water that flowed over the countless lingas of the river would fertilize the rice fields below. So they were doing Shivabhishekam, and then that water would come into the rice fields. So in certain ways, these people were even more devotional than people in India in certain senses. A short hike up the mountain will take a visitor to the place of 1,000 lingas at Kabalspian, and I have some pictures from that. The first inscriptions found on temple walls dating back to 5th century resembled a script used by Pallavas of South India. Later, so inscriptions is the script. So it was basically Tamil was there. Sanskrit and Tamil was there in Cambodian temples. Later, the Khmer developed their own script and carved them into walls, mostly describing the temple and its deity. But sometimes the inscriptions were just mundane list of inventory. Many inscriptions in Sanskrit language as well as in the Khmer language. So the first decade of 11th century witnessed the ascent of throne of a powerful king, Suryavarman, who unified almost all of the Kambojas and southern Thailand. He was also a busy builder of temples and royal palaces. Following his rule, Suryavarman II further expanded the kingdom. He also built the glorious temple of Angkor Wat. From the Indian words, Nagaravata, city temple, means it's a temple which is in the city itself, as opposed to going somewhere else. So the pinnacle of temples built in Cambodia. Even today, most of Cambodia is running on Hindu tourism, right? People from all over the world come to see this beautiful masterpiece. Nobody has been able to replicate that. The sprawling temple spreads over 1 square mile area. Long walls with stories of Hindu mythology are sculpted on bas reliefs. That's the wrong word. Hindu mythology. Hindu is not a mythology. It is a history. This is the challenge with moderners, right? They call everything a myth. It is a magnificent temple complex constructed in the form of Mount Meru, the Hindu center of the universe. Remember, I was talking about Mount Meru in some of our previous classes, which is the center of the universe, and around that you have Bhugola, and then you have Saptasamudra. The temple is surrounded by a large moat, means water, representing the ocean surrounding Mount Meru. And in some temples, interestingly, they have 7 moats. Moats means concentric ring waters to represent the ocean of milk, ocean of liquor, ocean of salt water, ocean of sweet water, like that. The brilliant paint used to enhance the reliefs has faded, but the architecture and beauty are still preserved. All the gods of the Hindu pantheon are represented in the temple sculpture. Shiva and Vishnu are held in high esteem. Ramayana and Kurukshetra war are depicted on the entire walls of stone sculptures. A masterpiece bas relief. Bas relief means like when you sculpt it, right? So it will form a relief. Means like there will be ups and downs. That's called relief. So masterpiece bas relief is that of legendary churning of ocean by gods and demons, which is the Samudra Manthan from Srimad Bhagavatam, right? And ironically, right now, Tamil Nadu with Anna DMK and DMK, they are believing less and less in God, right? Vast majority. There are still many temples, but less and less people are believing in that. So sculptures of Vishnu on the back of his carrier Garuda, on reclining on serpent Anantasesha, and Shiva with his consort Parvati are repeated in many temples. Also seen are Hanuman and Ganesh with many seductive figures of Apsaras, reminiscent of Devadasis, the consorts of the gods. So even in ISKCON, right, when somebody gets initiated, especially the ladies, they get entitled Devadasi. means servant of God. Another colorful king, Jayavarman 7, followed Suryavarman 2. The kingdom had briefly fallen into hands of the Chams of Champa. Champa, they are from Vietnam, and we'll come to that. Champas also, they still wear very Indian-like clothes, and they put big baskets on their head in procession. Very similar to temples in India, very similar. But the warrior like Jayavarman 7 reclaimed it and united Kambuja once again. He expanded his kingdom to include South Malaya and North Laos, as well as Champa. Burmese kingdoms, including Java, became subsidiaries. Means this became the primary seat of power. Because by that time, India was under the influence of Muslim rule. The Muslims started attacking and taking over bits and pieces. So these people were no longer under Hastinapura or modern-day Delhi. So Jayavarman VII was married to a Buddhist woman, and later he became a Buddhist himself. Builder of dozen or more significant temples and palaces, including the great Angkor Thom. He built many Buddhist monasteries and converted many Hindu temples into Buddhist shrines. And later Muslim came, and then they broke the Hindu temples and the Buddhist shrines both. Right? So whatever is left is our good luck. That's it. The elephant terrace and the statue of the leper king are in Angkor Thom. A statue when first found with blunted fingers was first thought to be a leper. The French mistook the weather damaged fingers to be that of a leper. But in fact, it was that of Yama, the king of death. The elephant terrace is a ceremonial altar in facing the royal square, supported by beautifully carved figures of elephants and mystical creatures. At the entrance of Angkor Thom is a large tower, large enough to admit elephants. On either side of the road near the entrance are rows of large statues with an angelic face on one side and scornful evil face on the other. So you see this tree, how old this tree must be. Its roots are basically pulverizing the building and going down like that. Jayavarman VII declared himself to be Bodhisattva as opposed to Devaraja, God King. Devaraja means followers in the Vishnu Vaishnava line. He declared himself to be Bodhisattva. This is from the Buddhist line, right? So nobody can become a Buddha, but you can become a Bodhisattva like that. His delusions of grandeur are evident in sculptures of colossal facial images of himself from temples, especially at the towers of Bayan. So he started thinking he himself was God. This is the challenge with Buddhism. Either they think they are nothing, or they think that they themselves are God. And when somebody thinks they themselves are God, it is actually no longer Buddhism, it is Mayavad. So the Mahayana Buddhism has been introduced to Kambuja, which in turn marked the beginning of the end of glorious Hindu era. So following Jayavarman VII's death, skirmishes arose. Again, both within the kingdom and bordering regions. Right, Brahmins tried to reset their authority with help of Jayavarman 8 and tried to usurp the Buddhist power. So when the Buddhism got introduced to Cambodia, Hinduism went away. And then again, the grandson Jayavarman 8, when he took over, he again tried to reassert the Brahminical authority. However, the influence did not last long, and soon after his death, Buddhism returned again. Though it was not Mahayana Buddhism, but it was Hinayana Buddhism. It's a different flavor of Buddhism. So it is called Theravada Buddhism in some parts, and took the final foothold and still remains in the dominant religion of Cambodia. The advent of Buddhism effectively put stop to building spree, because only the Hindu kings started building massive temples. Even in India, if you go to Vrindavan area, you'll see massive rock temples. Only the Hindu kings were interested in building glorious temples for the Lord. Some of the existing Hindu temples were converted to Buddhist temples and monasteries, and they were replaced with statues of Buddha. Although Buddha himself was an incarnation of Krishna, they did that because everybody wanted their own power. Right? So I'll just focus on the bullet points, stone inscriptions. That is one basis for understanding the Hindu history of Cambodia. Second is reliefs in a series of temple walls with depiction of military marches, life in palace, market scenes, and everyday life of population. Reports and chronicles of Chinese diplomats, traders, and travelers. And the beginning of era of the Khmer Empire is conventionally dated to 802 AD after death of whatever. And in the year King Jayavarman II had himself declared Chakravarti. Chakravarti is again an Indian term, king of the world or king of kings. So we get a lot of information from the stone murals, an account from a Chinese traveler called Zhu Duguan. Because Chinese used to travel to India and to parts of Southeast Asia and document stuff. Like for example, India was visited by Fa Hian. They offer first-hand accounts of 13th century and earlier, the ancient Khmer relied on rice growing, right? And the farms were irrigated by barrays or giant water reservoirs, which are built around temples like that. So it's all the culture that is being described here. So Jayavarman II is the founder of the Angkor area and Angkor Wat temple. We covered this also, I'll skip. Then there is also a place called, first city of Angkor was called Yashodharpura. Yashodharapura. So you know Mother Yashodhara was Krishna's mother. So the name of first city in that Angkor region is named after Mother Yashoda. Very interesting, right? The central temple building was built on Phnom Bakeng, a hill, right? Above the plain on which Angkor, the town, sits. At the beginning of the 10th century, the kingdom split. Jayavarman IV established a new capital, Kokher. So there were two capitals now. And then some people were running the show, like Rajendra Varman was running Yashodharapura. So you can see then at from 968 to 10, 1001 AD, king of Rajendra Varman, he established himself as a king, and they were continuing to use Sanskrit names like Jayena Nagari, means Nagar of victory. Nagar means city, Jaya means victory. So you can see that the whole of Cambodia was a Hindu kingdom back then. Then Suryavarman II, Angkor Wat was dedicated to God Vishnu. Suryavarman II conquered the Mon kingdom of Haripunjaya. Even that was a Vaishnava kingdom, Haripunjaya. And that is there in central Thailand. When I went to Thailand, I went to the king's palace. On the walls was beautifully painted Ramayana. Like I did not see anything so beautiful even in India, paintings of Ramayana. So somehow, because India was attacked by Muslims so many times, Indian heritage is all lost, except probably in the South India because the Muslims didn't come that far. But most of Indian culture was destroyed. But whereas if you go to Thailand, it's fantastic. Even in Bali, it's fantastic. So Thai province of Nakhon Si Thammarat. In the east, several provinces of Champa and the country. So Champa now is Vietnam, right? So each one of these provinces became a different country, right? Kingdom of Bagan is modern day Burma. So Burma is like a British name. Bagan is the original name. So this is how it is. So the last inscription which mentions his name is in connection with planned invasion of Vietnam. So Vietnam is, again, what is the name? Champa. Champa is the Vietnamese name. Like even in India, sometimes people have names like Champakalata. So all these are originally Indian names. Like even in Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is a gopi. Her name is Champakalata. So the whole world was one, right? Just from the short story of Cambodia, you know that the whole world was one at one point. They were all following Vaishnava culture. So here's the picture of Lord Brahma sitting on the lotus flower, and a different picture, you'll see that this lotus flower is attached to the nabi or the, what is it called? Navel of Lord Vishnu. And you see these, they carved on the right side, they carved Shivalingas on the base of the river, river of thousand lingas, that's why it's called. So as water flew over it, the linga slowly eroded. And right now you can still see those individual lingas, but they are not very tall. And here is the picture. The previous picture was this, Brahma sitting on the lotus flower. Now this is Lord Vishnu. And then Lakshmi Devi is pressing his feet. And from the Nabhi is this. So this is the typical picture in so many South Indian temples. So how did it end up in Cambodia? It's all, and then it's also on the rock. It's not like somebody transported some deities there. No, it was carved in the mountain rock. So entire Cambodia was Vaishnava. This is the other view when there was no flood. The previous view was when the water was flooding. So water was coming somewhere covering one third of Lord Vishnu. But this is summertime, apparently. So there's no water. And you can see there is a zoom. There is a zoom of this Brahma image here on the side for a close-up look. This is five Shivalingas in one place. They are all eroded right now. That's why you will see them just like a little bit tall, not very tall. Here is one other view of a Shiva and Parvati going on Nandi here. See this? Shiva, Parvati, Nandi. Some of them are broken, of course, passage of time. Again, one more summer view of the river of thousand lingas. And they actually call him Shiva. I mean, they don't call him something else. We also have Shiva on this conference call today. Somebody with the name Shiva. So one more view here, summer. So you can see the Shivalingas, you can touch them. Rainy season, Shivalingas are underwater. This is like water flowing very rapidly, Shivalingas. And this is the banyan tree that I showed you previously, right? It's like basically destroying the building and the roots are making their way down, down, down. This was supposed to be like a rooftop tree and now it is subduing the building. This is one other view of the Kabal's PM, which is Lord Vishnu's depiction. And you see Sheshnag here with various heads. So now let's go to Indonesia. If you go to Indonesia, you will see again lot of Hinduism, lot of Vedic culture. This is, who is this? Who is this standing here? Who is this? Anybody know?
Yeah, Narasimha bro.
Narasimha, yeah. He has his Vishnu Chakra here, Sudarshan Chakra. And he has his Tavakara Kamalavare Nakam Adbhuta Shringam. Shringam means these nails. Dalita Hiranyakashipu Thanu Bringan. Breaking the body of Hiranyakashipu. Right? And blood is coming and intestines are coming. Keshavadrita Narahari Rupa. Body of a Nara and head of a Simha. So that's why it's called Narasimha. So what do? They put a big figurine of Narasimha and all these people are dancing, dancing to the right, dancing to the left, doing a Leela. Even in India, they don't do Leela like this. Very amazing countries. After researching all this, I felt like going to Bali, definitely. And it seems to be the most fascinating place on earth. Most people go there for honeymoon, but this is the real thing. You are seeing Lord Narasimhadev in public. They are dancing with Lord Narasimhadev. We only dance in front of Lord Narasimhadev. They actually dance with Lord Narasimhadev. That's even more powerful. And you see the temples in the back? So attractive. And here's the other thing. These are all called Gohmukhs. Like in every temple has some water pond, right? And then from the mountains, the water comes and from the mouths of, they will make mouths in the shape of a cow. And then if you take bath at the Gohmukh, it is considered to be pious. And you have like a Bali Brahmin on the right side, right? He's guiding these Matajis to do the puja. So they have plates full of flowers. Amazing pictures. I was like so thrilled. And see how beautifully they made. This is, who do you think the person on the left is? To your left. How many heads does he have? Ravana.
Ravana?
Yeah, Ravana. He's got heads, right? I mean, like in India, they show Ravana with heads one next to each other. Here they show heads one on top of each other, like a hierarchy. And who is in the middle? The sage? Vyasa. Right? So they're praying to Vyasa. And who is this big boar here at the bottom? Varaha. Yeah, these are all Dashavataras they're depicting. Somewhere Lord Ram is coming behind. See, this is the procession, as you can see, right? So we are in the first front face. At the back of Vyasa, you see a muscular man there. That is Lord Ram coming in the back. Such a beautiful, no? We should learn this for our Ananda Mela. And look at how beautifully they made the temples. Every temple has so much artwork, just like Kanchipuram temples in India. This is another temple. Look how nice it looks, right? Like normally if you go outside a temple in India, you will see somebody selling tea, somebody selling some cheap tiny toys. This is like so serene. This is the procession I was talking about. So what used to happen in Indian temples thousands of years ago, till today it's happening in Bali temple. Women carry all the fruits offering for the Lord on their heads. You see that? This woman is carrying four layers of fruits. The woman at the back is carrying like five or six layers of vegetables. See that? She's carrying a variety of vegetables on the top. So the tradition continues. So it's not like only India is a Hindu country. No. You have other countries where it is being preserved. Look at that beautiful artwork of the temple. Right? Very unique style, their own style. Everything flares out on the top. If you see, everything is flaring out. This is Ganesha sitting. This is in front of a temple. They're growing lotuses so that they can offer to Lord Vishnu. Vishnu, the best flower he likes is lotus. In Seattle, we don't have lotus, so we give him marigolds, which is the forest flower here. This is one other entrance to the temple. And you see, everywhere in temples, you have lions. And in Indian temples also, you have lions outside guarding the buildings, right? Here at the top, there is a mouth of a lion. More lions. If you go to Jagannath Puri, you will see a lot of lions guarding the Jagannath Puri temple. So the same tradition continues. All the Divyadesham in Sri Vaishnava, they have lions outside. Here are the fruit and flower offerings in beautiful bamboo and plantain leaves. Look at how beautiful it is, temple from a far sight. Lawns maintained nicely. And women, they wear, just like in India, they wear on the forehead, the tilak. They decorate their head very nicely and then participate in the procession. So Bali's heritage, there was a king called Majapahit, right? And he controlled many other kingdoms like Borneo, Malay Peninsula, Sumatra, Kalimantan. Kalimantan, they believe that Lord Krishna did Kalimantan there, right? When we think Krishna did Kaliamardana or Kalimantan in banks of Yamuna River. So it's like that. And when Kaliya was subdued by Lord Krishna, Krishna ordered Kaliya to leave the place and go somewhere. And so apparently she came here to Kalimantan, that Fiji area. Even Philippines has Vedic culture, but of course it's now all lost now. Even India, it's all lost. Who's talking about these things? Right now, everybody will be watching a movie in India and we are doing devotional activity. So what happened after the decline of the Majapahit Empire in 15th century? all the Hindu priests from Bali, they left and they went to other places. So they were also migrating from country to country. They were all provinces once upon a time, but later on they became countries. So Hinduism came to dominate Balinese culture, and the Dutch control of the archipelago helped mitigate religious violence. So at least the Dutch control stopped the Muslims from killing Hindus there in that peninsula. So when Indonesia gained independence in 45, 2 years before us, right? So we thought we were one of the first to get independence. Apparently Indonesia was even before us. In 1952, Indonesia Minister of Religion declared only monotheistic faiths would meet their definition of religion. So Balinese Hindus basically said, yeah, we are also monotheistic. And then Balinese Hindus recognized the classic Indian trinity, Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, and local derived deities. So ethical values reflect those of Indian Hinduism and typically passed down through families rather through religious schools. Whereas if you look at the Muslim parampara, they send them to Muslim schools and they are given rigorous training there. What are those Muslim schools called? Anybody know?
Madrasas, right?
Madrasas, yeah. Correct, correct. Even in Seattle, there is a madrasa. My former boss's children were sent there to be, you know, indoctrinated into the religion. But the Hindu values are typically passed through families. Like in India, Indian Hinduism caste system has been the norm, which is Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Shudra. Balinese Hindus avoid eating animals, like apparently locals eat tigers, dogs, crocodiles, but these people don't eat. So most important festival is Galungan, similar to Indian festival of Diwali around the same time when Lord Ram defeated Ravana. Is not held at the same time. However, this has got Balinese calendar has only 210 days. So they don't follow the Western calendar. They still stick to the traditional calendar. On the last day of celebration called Kuningan, spirits are said to depart earth and return. So apparently spirit of deceased ancestors come during this Galungan, Diwali equivalent, Deepavali equivalent. Then you have Naiyapi, falls in March, which is similar to what we have Ugadi in India, Yugadi. Adi means beginning of the Yuga, Yugadi. So day of silence, 24 hours, nobody talks anything. Wow, that's very interesting. Entire island essentially shuts down. So life of Balinese Hindus marked by social ceremonies, purify the soul and propitiate evil spirits. Baby is considered to be a god for first 42 days and not allowed to touch the impure ground. Very interesting. At puberty, a young girl's upper canine teeth are filed so that they are all at the same level. So a lot of nice traditions. This is Mother Saraswati on the left side. And here a Balinese woman on the right side is lighting lamps for all the various devatas outside the temple. If you see, their wooden temples are very, very nicely preserved. You see this wood on the right side, which is very amazing. I went to Thailand, the wooden temples are preserved very nice. So Southeast Asia somehow seems to have a slightly better culture amongst the Hindus than in India right now. Our people don't even care about the temple. I went to Srirangam, all papers on the ground, beggars are allowed to beg there, very unclean, dirty. But other parts of the world seem to be doing well. So here are other two long shots. So they are called Puras, right? Puram, Puram as they say, right? Are designed in accordance with religious beliefs. They are generally open outdoor spaces with gates, shrines, pavilions. The temples are typically divided into three mandalas. Like if you do a keyword search on internet, mandala, to design a temple, you have to follow a mandala actually. But right now we are not. There are 20,000 temples in Bali. Can you believe that? 20,000. Of course, Muslims destroyed 40,000 temples in India. So tough. What can we do? So most famous temple is Mother Temple of Baisakhi, largest and holiest on island. You have a similar festival in Punjab called Baisakhi. So there may be some connection there. Although majority are foreign tourists. Right? So there are the Temanayun Temple, Ulun Danu Temple. So then we come to Vietnam. So you remember we talked about when we were talking about the first one, we said that that king Jayavarman defeated the Champas. So Champas in short are called Cham in Vietnam. And they are the only surviving Hindus. Once upon a time, Vietnam was a very vibrant Hindu country. Nowadays, it's all gone. The many magnificent temples and artifacts from Angkor Wat to Prambanan remain as potent testimonials to their splendor and accomplishments. Champa was a formidable Hindu country, kingdom, immense wealth and sophisticated culture. Major port was Kattigara. 2000 years ago, Claudius Ptolemy wrote of Kattigara and outlined in his map of the world. He's a forerunner of Saigon, modern Ho Chi Minh City. Kattigara was in fact the main port at the mouth of the Mekong River. Mekong is named after Mother Ganga. My Nam Kong means mother water, Ganga. My means mother. And ironically, or interestingly, Krishna used to call his mother Maya. Maya. Maya, Yashoda, Ye Tera, Ye Kana. That's how the song goes. Maya means mother in that Vrindavan area and in good part of North India. So, mother water Ganga. So, that port of the mouth of the main port is called Mekong. Mother water Ganga. So, Swaminathan, he did some research. And he said that the first king was known as Srimaran. He came from Tamil Nadu. And he went to Vietnam. But he was not Chola, like, no, sorry, not, what is it? Pallava king. Pallava kings went to Cambodia. But this was Pandyan king who went to Vietnam. Thirumaran. Right? So Srimaran became Thirumaran because of the Tamil influence. So, but the Sanskrit inscription, it says his name was Srimaran. So another early Champa king was Bhadravarman. Remember in Cambodia, everybody had the title Varman, named after Varmas in India. His capital was the citadel of Simhapura. Right? We are talking about Vietnam. We are not talking about, you know, some place in Warangal or in Meenakshipuram or Tiruchirappalli. This is in Vietnam that they had names like Simhapura. Bhadravarman built a number of temples, conquered his rivals, ruled well, and in his final years abdicated the throne and spent his last days in India. So he actually went to India to die, right? He didn't want to leave his body in Vietnam. So he came to Ganga River. So we have to also either invite Mother Ganga to Seattle or go to India and you know, die in Vrindavan or someplace or in Mayapur near Ganga River. Even now, a lot of people go to Mayapur in their last days and they pass their body near Ganga. Because that's a very pious place. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was there. So many historical events happened there. Very pious place. So today, there were five regions. Indrapura, currently they call it Dong Duong. All this Chinese influence has increased and serves the religious center. Amaravati is a very famous place in India, Amaravati. Now that is called Quang Nam. Vijaya is now Chaban. Kautara is Natrang. And Panduranga is simply Phan. So Panduranga became Phan. Panduranga was the last Cham territory to be conquered by the Sino. Sino means Chinese. Sino-Vietnamese. So Chinese influence finished a lot of that tradition. So Christopher Columbus, he attempted to reach the Champa Kingdom and actually believed he reached Vietnam. So there was a lot of trade between India, Europe and Southeast Asia back then. So Columbus was convinced that sailing west from Spain, he could circle the globe, concept ridiculed by most Europeans who still believed the earth was flat, and thus found a new trade route, right? So he wanted to find India and he went to found America, where we are living right now. So also Marco Polo, he followed from China to India in 1292 and he reached Carrier on the coast of Costa Rica. So these people started in one place and ended up in somewhere else. So Marco Polo reached South Africa, South America. But he thought he found Vietnam. So what he found, thought was Vietnam, was actually Costa Rica. So the Champa Kingdom or Vietnam had very good gold mines, right? So fortunately for Vietnam, he was mistaken, because otherwise everybody would have invaded Vietnam and finished it. So the capital of Vietnam was Funan. Vietnamese Hindu kingdom was Funan and its capital was Ho Chi Minh Citadel. So when exploring sea passages to India, everybody wanted to come to India back then, because India had the most gold, most pearls, most diamonds. And after looting everything, now nobody wants to go to India. So Kang Dai and Zhu Ying described Funan as having its own taxation system, ruled by king in walled palace. So yeah, there was a significant free trade between Hokkyo, which was the place in Persia. Sorry, not Persia. It was a place in Funan, and then between Persia and Rome. So there was a lot of trade between the Hindu kingdom of Funan, which was in Vietnam, and then with these other major places. America back then was nothing going on here. Even now, from a spiritual perspective, there's nothing going on in America. Everything you have to, like one person said, if you want to know God, you have to go to the East. So here's a figurine of the 10 hands of Lord Vishnu, but then part of theirs were cut down. So yeah, Naga Prabhu, can you read this?
In ancient time, the Champa built vast temple complexes that remains standing to this day. Primarily dedicated to Lord Shiva, these structures honor Lord Shiva as the founder and protector of the Champa dynasty. The most important of these is known as Mysan, a Hindu religious and literacy center. Originally, this temple complex featured 70 structures, of which 25 survive. Sadly, the main tower was severely damaged by American bombers in 1969 during the Vietnam War. The Shivalingam was the primary form worshipped at Mysan. Its an iconic form also represents the divine authority of the Shiva-empowered king. Today, the Cham people continue to worship this form of Lord. The site of the ancient Sun Tin Tupango, atop Mount Ba is still considered to be one of the most spiritual and sacred places in all of Vietnam. There on a 3 meter high granite rock is the Ban Chanti, a footprint belonging to the god who set his footstep on soft land at the dawn of humankind. Located Shivalingam and the Yoni, its walls are lined with seated Ganesh Murtis. Many Hindu artifacts of significant historical value have been found in Vietnam. In 2001, 320 gold plates were discovered, decorated with various Hindu divinities such as Garuda, Narasimha, Kurma, and Durga. These plates have been identified as the earliest known god iconographic image ever discovered in Southeast Asia. Starting in the 1940s, many valuable OCO artifacts have been unearthed, featuring statues and reliefs of Buddha, Ganesh, Vishnu, Durga, and Shiva in both his human and iconic linga form. Many Vietnamese Hindu artifacts have been misidentified as Buddhist icons. One such example is the Ben Hau Vishnu, which bears all the markings of Vishnu and is identified as such by the Sanskrit inscriptions on its back. The sculpture, dated to 10 CE, was commissioned by Prince Vijaya Kalunachampa in gratitude and as a symbol of Vishnu's blessing for his conquest over the Chenla. Lost for centuries and rediscovered 100 years ago, the Ben Hau Vishnu has been worshipped ever since as Buddha by the local community. In June 2013, Vietnamese Prime Minister officially identified 30 national treasures of integral import to the nation. Among these are several Hindu artifacts, including murtis of Vishnu and Surya from the OCEO culture, and of Durga and Shiva from the Champa.
If you remember right, like OCEO was one of their capitals. So Champa was the original dynasty and OCEO is the relatively modern dynasty. So from both places, you are seeing Vishnu, Surya, Durga and Shiva.
The fifth Quan Nam Heritage Festival, held June 21st, 2013, featured a Vishnu sculpture dated 3,500 to 4,000 years ago. If this dating proves accurate, this sculpture would be the oldest known identifiable Hindu artifacts in the world.
Okay, they say that like that, but in reality, every day, whenever somebody digs something in ancient temple towns, they are finding older and older deities, right? Not much excavation has happened. Once they excavate more and more ancient locations, you will see more and more ancient. Because this Sanatan Dharma means eternal religion. It has been there since dawn of humanity 2 billion years ago. So as archaeologists keep digging, like I did in one of my earlier classes, all these older things keep coming. So here Vietnamese ladies who are carrying these things on their head, very similar to the Cambodian ladies, very similar to the Indian ladies carrying offerings to the Lord like that. And if you look at this classic Champa dance, it is nothing but Bharatanatyam. You see that? That mudra is very much a Bharatanatyam mudra. Especially this, the lady on the back, because my daughter learned Bharatanatyam, that's how I know. These are definitely Bharatanatyam mudras. Yeah, continue.
The Wokan inscription, among the oldest known Sanskrit inscriptions discovered in the region, is one of the many discovered in modern times. The Darang River, the largest river valley in these riverside inscriptions often lay hidden beneath the waterline, only to be revealed during the dry summer months. The Cham script is a descendant of the South Indian Brahmanic Grantha script.
Yeah, so as Hindu stones, just like in Cambodia, we saw that Vishnu's figurines, deities, only in summer, right? In the rainy season they were covered. So that's how they designed even here. And South Indian Brahmic Grantha script. So South Indian Brahmic Grantha script is the mother of Telugu, Tamil, Malayalam and Kannada. That was the original script. So that script is actually there. It's still there. And then Cham script or Champa script is a descendant of that. Yeah, continue.
And many Hindu stone temples of the Champa includes both Sanskrit and Charmic stone carvings. The various Cham communities use slightly modified versions of the script, although the Cham Muslims prefer to use the Arabic alphabets. During French colony rule, both groups were forced to use the Latin script. Though the Cham script is still highly valued, and despite effort to simplify the spellings, today few peoples are actually learning it. While the Brahmic-based Cham language is still spoken by nearly 250,000 people. At one time, Sanskrit was common for the educated. Interestingly, the spread of written Sanskrit in India seems to have nearly coincided with its use in Vietnam and elsewhere in Southeast Asia. The evidence speaks of an ongoing vibrant Sanskrit-based Hindu civilization and was never handicapped by narrow ethnical or national limitations, but rather was nearly global in scope.
Yeah, so it shows that Sanskrit, which was there in the Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, at the same time, it was also spoken in Vietnam and elsewhere in Southeast Asia. So Southeast Asian culture, that's why even till today, they are not too greedy. I mean, in the last 10, 15 years, with the advent of internet, everybody is seeing all these ads from Europe and America. Little bit of their mindset is changing. But until recently, until about 20, 25 years ago, they were very, very self-contented people, God-fearing people like that. But now internet and the free flow of cultures is destroying that. Yeah, maybe Shiva, you can read this.
A small number of the Vietnamese Cham, also known as Eastern Cham, follow Islam, and a relative few follow Mahayan Buddhism, but the majority are Hindu. These are called the Balamon, Brahman people. It is claimed that 70% of the Balaman people are classed as Kshatriyas. Having survived the loss of their kingdom, the colonial tyranny of the French, the Vietnam War, during which an unknown number of emigrated to France, communist rule and economic mayhem, the Cham Balaman people and traditions are surprisingly intact. Their temples are still standing. Their festivals are still celebrated, and the traditional Hindu ceremonies and worship continue. Life passages such as graduations, weddings, births, and deaths are still observed in accordance with the Hindu traditions. Along with the Balinese Hindus, the Cham Balaman represent the only remaining non-Indic populations of indigenous Hindus surviving today. But the Cham are not immune to the problems of modern times. The young are focused on material well-being with little time or commitment to ancestral ways. Although there are few courageous efforts to protect and promote the rich traditions of Cham Hinduism, there is a long way to go.
Yeah, so just like everywhere else, young Indians are giving up their traditional ways. Young Vietnamese are also giving up their traditional ways. But of course, you know, the preachers from Islam and all that, they are still pretty strong. So a good number of people are getting sucked into Islam. So that is how Hinduism's problems are manifesting, right? Because they are not enough preachers. So we need more preachers. And that is why I'm teaching the class, so that you three can then go teach three other people and then take this knowledge forward. Hindus are just concerned with material well-being. Dharma, artha, kama, moksha. do a little bit of dharma. Don't do too much, just a little bit, enough to get artha, money, due to pious activities. And then with a little bit of money, do kama, do sense gratification, enjoy life. And then in the end, think of their individual moksha, but not really teach other people this knowledge. So we need more teachers. Lack of teachers, this path will eventually deteriorate. But as long as you, even a few teachers are remaining, they'll teach the next generation. So we have to see how this whole thing will evolve over a period of time. So here is the rainy season. It's called the Kate Festival. Beautifully dressed, right? Okay, continue, Shiva. Shiva, can you continue reading?
What is the origin of the Balaman people? The research has not come to a clear conclusion yet. Now it is said that we come from somewhere in Java. It is known that we built our culture from 3000 to 5000 years ago in our land. Tell us about the Balaman region. It is hard to decide if Balaman is a religion or just a system of beliefs. Though our ancestors have left us with the Hindu scriptures, yet history might have burned down to the textbooks, all the textbooks. We have now only books or texts to show belief, stories of the kings, gods, and the performing of rituals. What is your most important festival? It could be said it is our new year called Rija Nagar, or the nation's festival. It is most important since it has common value and is celebrated by Ayer, Hindus, and our Muslims, together with its very beautiful and philosophical dances. Are the Balaman traditions and culture popular among the young people? Since there is no clear belief system, we can say that it is not popular. Though the lifestyle, by which I mean artistic, joyful, and spiritual, is seen as popular. What connections do your people have with India, past and present? Our kingdom at its very early stage, 192 CE, adopted Hinduism as its religion and had the tradition connection ever since. About 1,000 years later, as the merchants stopped coming to Southeast Asia, its influence fell, replaced by the growing power of Islam. The Indian researchers and friends who have come to Pandrang to see the culture have said much Indian influence can still be seen today, especially in some of the beliefs and the Hindu temples. Do people still worship at the ancient Hindu temples? Yes. We have four temples that are still worshipped in nowadays. Poinu Nugar, Poru, Poinilam Girai, and Podam.
Yeah, so influence can be seen from thousands of years ago, but modern day, the trade between India and Vietnam came down. Yeah, go ahead.
Mouse was struggling. Okay. As for my son heritage, we have lost our land and so we have not reached there since long ago. But that is still the holy ground that people would love to visit. What are the biggest challenges facing the Cham people? Keeping our culture, language, and traditions alive is generally the challenge from hundreds of years ago, as the influence from Vietnam grows greater. Now, not many young people know how to read or speak properly or clearly understand our beliefs. What are the most treasured artifacts of the Cham? The temples or the small wooden frame kept by the three highest priests that represent the temples are the most important. They are used when we need to perform rituals while we cannot reach the temples because of warfare. Are there any official efforts to protect and promote Cham dance music and art? There are none that officially teach or study Cham history or and traditions. Anyway, the need is high since long ago. Now we have the Cham brand of the Vietnam Association of Ethnology, focusing on fostering social activity for Cham in Saigon. Also, we have Cham language classes and the Cham UNESCO form that focuses on studies.
Yeah, they actually, this is more like the modern talk that they are doing. But you get the idea. Dharmic based Hindu civilization is what the Chams are following. But then that's, looking to India, Hinduism continues to thrive in India. Yet today, it's only among the Balinese and Cham Balamon people that this once global expression of Hinduism survives unbroken. Vietnam, with its ancient and impressive Hindu heritage, has age-old ties with India. The Cham Balamon people continue to practice their venerable Hindu traditions and express a keen interest in visiting India and holy sites. So there is some connection, but the key point is you have seen Cambodia has Hindu roots. Bali has Hindu roots. And then you have Vietnam that has Hindu roots. So here's the sanctuary in Vietnam. It looks pretty beautiful. Pretty, pretty beautiful. And on the left side, you see those arches. And just like the Gopuram in South India, they have the concept of Gopuram also. There's a Shivalinga here in Mai Son Sanctuary in Vietnam. And then here is the mandala, Thap Ai Mai Son. So this is the description of a mandala, which is very similar to the mandalas that temples are used. See, temple has this concentric, so this is the outer ring, this is the inner ring, and then this is the sanctum sanctorium. That's how it should be. Temple should have entry from all four sides, and temple should be the center of the city, right? So all this was following just like the ancient Vedic tradition. So the ancient Vedic tradition is still there across all these countries, right? So the king called Bhadravarman, literally means, Varman means armor. Bhadra is armor. So Varman is like the blessed king. Okay. Sarvana, can you read, please?
Yes, Prabhu. But my son Shiva Vishnu temple history. Bhadravarman built a hall containing a lingam to worship Shiva under the Sanskrit name Bhadreshwara, blessed Lord, a composite created from the king's own name and the word Ishwara, Lord, commonly used to refer to Shiva. He erected a stele at Maison, which has inscription that he has dedicated the entire valley of Maison to Bhadreshwara. The text ends with a plea from Bhadravarman to his successors, out of compassion for me, do not destroy what I have given. Drawing upon the doctrines of samsara and karma, if you destroy my foundation, all your good deeds in your different births shall be mine, and all the bad deeds done by me shall be yours. If on the contrary, you properly maintain the endowment, the merit shall belong to you alone. Bhadravarman's successors heard his plea, for my son became the religious hub of Champa for many generations. My son's sanctuary, Vietnam, Sambhu Bhadreshwara temple, map more than two centuries after Bhadravarman's foundation. The Bhadreshwara temple was destroyed by fire. The 7th century king Sambhu Varman from Phan Chi in Vietnam is Phan Che as transcribed from the Chinese, who reigned from 577 until 629 CE. Rebuilt the temple, reinstalled the god under the name Sambhu Bhadreshwara, and erected a stele to document the event. This stele affirmed that Sambhu Bhadreshwara was the creator of the world and the destroyer of sin, and expressed the wish that he cause happiness in the kingdom of Champa. The stele also applauded the king himself, claiming that he was like a terrestrial sun illuminating the night, and that his glory rose like the moon on an autumn evening. In 605 CE, Chinese general Liu Fang led an army southwards from the area of what is now northern Vietnam, defeated the elephant riders of Sambuvarman, and sacked the Cham capital, making off with an enormous booty that included over 1,000 Buddhist books, as well as the gold tablets commemorating the reigns of the previous 18 kings. Heading back north with their haste, the Chinese invaders were struck by an epidemic that felled a large number of them, including Liu Fang. Sambuvarman, for his part, returned home to his kingdom, began the process of rebuilding, and made sure to send regular shipments of tribute to the Chinese court in order through appeasement to prevent a recurrence of the recent disaster. The original temple map was reconstructed by scholars after bombing destroyed the original edifice during Vietnam War. King Prakashadharma, Pokia Phopamo, as transcribed from the Chinese, ruled Champa from 653 AD to 687 CE. Upon coronation, he assumed the name Vikrantavarman and expanded the borders of Champa towards the south. He was dedicated to both gods Shiva and Vishnu, which was unusual for Champa kings. In later years, Maisan served as the religious and cultural center of the Cham civilization in central Vietnam, as well as the burial place of kings and religious leaders.
Yeah, so you see so much rich history they have. All these names are so impressive, right? Prakasha Dharma, Shambhu Varman in Vietnam. Shambhu Bhadreshwara was the temple, right? Now we come to Thailand. So let's do this quickly. Yeah, continue.
Thailand, Thailand national emblem, symbol and royal seal of approval. Hinduism has played an influential role in the Thai royal household for centuries. It is this historic role which led to the adoption of Garuda as the national emblem of Thailand's royalty many centuries ago. Garuda was not officially accepted as the national emblem until Rama VI officiated it in 1911. Since then, it has been used to officiate both royal and governmental documents. Garuda may take on slightly different forms. As you see in the photos below, you will most commonly see examples of the first photo below on royal and government documents and used by many official organizations such as banks as a motif or seal of approval. The statue form of Garuda in the second photo below is commonly seen on and around temples and official buildings.
So this is the second photo that I put in, not the first photo, because this looks more impressive. Garuda is obviously the carrier of Lord Vishnu. And here he's seen carrying the temple of Lord Vishnu with his hands like that. Okay, go ahead.
Thailand has two ethnic Thai Brahmin communities, Brahm Luang, royal Brahmins, and Brahm Chawoban, folk Brahmins. The Brahm Luang, royal Brahmins, mainly perform royal ceremonies of the Thai king. They belong to the long family bloodline of Brahmins in Thailand. The Brahm Chawoban are folk Brahmins, or the category of Brahmins who are not from a bloodline of priests. Generally, these Brahmins have a small knowledge about the rituals and ceremonies. The Devasthan is the center of Brahmin activity in Thailand. It was built more than 200 years ago. Apart from this, there are also Indian Brahmins from India who migrated to Thailand.
So you see this? They have the terms Brahmins. They have the term Devasthan. So it is also an extension of the Vedic culture from India, even Thailand. So we covered Cambodia, Bali, Vietnam, and Thailand. Everything is Vedic. Yeah, go ahead.
The first Thai kingdom, Sukhothai, Sanskrit Sukhodaya, because of influence of neighboring Vaishnavite Angkor, showed considerable Hindu influence. Temples were built according to Vastu, with place for Mount Meru, etc. The first king of this dynasty was Indraditya. But even here, Buddhist Stavirvada influence was more than Hindu influence. The second Thai kingdom, Ayutthaya, Sanskrit Ayodhya, 1351 to 1767, also showed considerable Hindu influence, including codification of Hindu Dharma Shastras, but the official religion was Stavirvada Buddhism. Mostly because of loss of confidence with invasions, Indian Hinduism gradually ceased to be on the vigorous missionary religion that it was at the beginning of this millennium. Buddhist Sri Lanka, on the other hand, continued to exert cultural and religious influence all over Southeast Asia. Jina Kalamali. The Buddhist Chronicle records how Siamese monks were ordained in Sri Lanka, how kings sent monks to convert, etc. In most cases, Hindu practices and Buddhist religion existed side by side. Buddhist kings saw nothing wrong in getting Brahmins for court functions. Buddhist laities saw nothing wrong in worshipping Hindu gods along with the Buddha. Buddhist monks saw nothing wrong in reading Hindu cosmology books along with Vinaya, Tripitaka, etc. This was not too different from how it might have been in, for example, in Buddhist Kushana time or Satavahana time. Hinduism is still practiced normally in Thailand by Hindus. However, Brahmins are required in the royal Thai court for some events, such as the royal ploughing ceremony and other royal ceremonies, even though all of the Thai monarchies are currently Theravada Buddhist.
So although all the kings are Theravada Buddhist, still they require Brahmins to come to the Thai court to do it. And that's why, as I said, when I went to this Grand Palace in Thailand, Bangkok, it is amazing depiction of Ramayana, beautiful paintings. And I've not seen such beautiful paintings in India also, in the temples. But again, India has been a victim of so much of Muslim invasions that they pretty much finished everything. But now it's all coming back. Thanks to Narendra Modi, now we have the new Ayodhya temple being built. So there could be a period of revival of the Vedic culture. And again, if you chant Hare Krishna, Vedic culture will be revived, because that is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's benediction to us. So if you chant Hare Krishna, everything else will come back to its glory. Okay, continue.
Early history. In the 9th century BC, Mon and Khmer people established kingdoms that included large areas of what is now Thailand. Much of what these people absorbed from contacts with South Asian peoples, religious, social, political, and cultural ideas and institutions later influenced the development of Thailand's culture and national identity. In the 2nd century BC, the Hindu-led state of Funan in present-day Cambodia and central Thailand had close commercial contact with India and was a base for Hindu merchant missionaries. In the southern isthmus of Kra, Malay city-states controlled routes used by traders and travelers journeying between India and Indochina, present-day Cambodia, Laos, and Vietnam. Nan Chao period, 650 to 1250, located on the southwestern border of China's Tang Empire, 618 AD to 907 AD. Nan Chao was served as a buffer for and later rival to China. The Thai, a people who originally lived in Nan Chao, migrated into mainland Southeast Asia over a period of many centuries during the first millennium AD. Sukhothai period, 1238 to 1438. In 1238, a Thai chieftain, Sri Indraditya, declared his independence from Khmer overlords and established a kingdom at Sukhothai in the Chao Phraya Valley in central Thailand. The people of the central plain took the name Thai, which means free, to distinguish themselves from other Thai people still under foreign rule. The kingdom of Sukhothai conquered the isthmus of Kra in the 13th century and financed itself with war booty and tribute from vassal states in Burma, today Myanmar, Laos, and the Malay Peninsula. During the reign of Ram Kamheng, Rama the Great, 1279 to 98, Sukhothai established diplomatic relations with the Yuan dynasty, 1279 to 1368 in China, and acknowledged China's emperor as its nominal overlord.
Yeah, let's not get into them. Everything else is more the historical thing, right? Not spiritual, really. Yeah, continue.
Forged bronze implements as early as 3000 BC and cultivated rice during the 4th millennium BC. Early history. In the 9th century BC, Mon and Khmer people established kingdoms that included large areas of what is now Thailand. Much of what these people absorbed from contacts with South Asian peoples, religious, social, political...
I think this is just a duplicate. It's a duplicate of the previous one. Okay. So, yeah, this is the last slide. Go ahead, please.
During and following the Sukhothai period, the Thai-speaking kingdom of Lanna flourished in the north near the border with Burma. with its capital at Chiang Mai, the name also sometimes given to this kingdom, Lanna emerged as an independent city-state in 1296. Later, from the 16th to 18th centuries, Lanna came under the control of Burma. Ayutthaya period, 1350 to 1767. The city-state of Ayutthaya was founded in 1350 and established its capital in 1351 on the Chao Phraya River in central Thailand, calling it Ayutthaya after Ayodhya, the Indian city of the hero Rama in the Hindu epic Ramayana. In 1360, Ramati Bodhi, 1351 to 69, declared Theravada Buddhism as the official religion and compiled a legal code based on Hindu legal texts and Thai custom that remained in effect until the late 19th century.
So basically, Hindu legal text means Manusmriti. They still took the rules from Manusmriti that, you know, man has to have only one wife, not more than one. You should not kill the cow. All those rules from the Hindu text came into being.
Ayutthaya became the region's most powerful kingdom, eventually capturing Angkor and forcing the Khmer to submit to Thai suzerainty. So, rather than a unified kingdom, Ayutthaya was a patchwork of self-governing principalities and tributary provinces ruled by members of the royal family who owed allegiance to the king. The king, however, was an absolute monarch who took on godlike aspects. This belief in a divine kingship continued until the 18th century. The kingdom became increasingly sophisticated as new social, political, and economic developments took place.
Yeah. So what do you think? We covered four countries in Southeast Asia. All of them were Hindu. All of them believed in a godlike king, which is what Lord Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita. Raja Vidya Raja Guhyam. This knowledge is only given to kings and saints. And all of them had some connection to Lord Ram, Vishnu, or Krishna. To a certain degree, Shiva, and to a lesser degree, Shiva's consort Durga and Vinayaka or Ganesha. But yeah, it was there, very much there. So now where is it? It's all getting lost. So that is why Swami Prabhupada's point is to actually reinstate Vedic culture. This is why he has established ISKCON, International Society of Krishna Consciousness, to reinstate this culture. Actually, my Guru Maharaj Bhakti Vikas Swami, who is based in Salem, Tamil Nadu, but he has many preaching places in Gujarat, in Ujjain, in Madhya Pradesh, and in Srikakulam, in Andhra Pradesh, and in Karmandura, in Karnataka, like that. He went and preached in Cambodia, Thailand, and then he found that the Buddhist influence is pretty bad. So Buddhist influence is what? That there is no goal in life, right? You become nirvana. Nir means no, vana means existence. So you become non-existent. By meditation, you become nothing. It is called shunyavada. Shunyavada means you become nothing. So Srila Prabhupada's point is nirvishesha shunyavada paschata desa tarine. Srila Prabhupada came to destroy this tendency of nirvishesha or Buddhism. Nirvishesha means mayavadism, and Shunyavad means Buddhism. Shunya means zero. So what happens after death? You become zero. That is what the Buddhists preach, right? Although it came from the same root, the Vedic root, and it also came from India only. It didn't come from somewhere else. All major religions have their roots in India. It is not really going to take you to the final goal. And that is why it is to be rejected. That is Srila Prabhupada's position. So what do you think? No thoughts?
Amazing, Prabhu, this information, all these things. Really.
4 hours to collect all this.
Good to know.
4 hours to collect, 1 hour 40 to deliver.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Prabhu.